Hi everyone, this is Burgundy. This recording is of a yoga talks class from Wednesday, February 7th at 7:30. February and March, we are following, we're reading the book, The Yamas and Niyamas by Deborah Adele. This first week, we discussed the first chapter about ahimsa, which is nonviolence. We will read a chapter or two each week, again, ending in March. Feel free, if anybody is in the Columbus area, please stop by and join our discussion. Again, 7:30 to 8:30 at the Yoga Happiness Studio in Arcadia. If you haven't read the book or haven't read the chapter, don't worry. Come on in, sit down, and just enjoy talking with us about the topic. So without further ado, here is the first yoga talk session on the yamas. Enjoy. The book, The Yamas and Niyamas, Exploring Yoga's Ethical Practice. The yamas are the first limb of the eight limbs of yoga, and in looking at the descriptions of the chapters, you can see how these aspects are so important to building up your yoga practice, and why, you know, we talk so much about yoga is so much more than just asana. Can't emphasize that enough. In our Western world of going somewhere to get your ass kicked, you know, and believe me, I'm the last person to knock having a great physical experience. I mean, I'm a runner, you know, I enjoy that, the endorphin rush. I love to sweat. I love the feeling of like my muscles aching and the stuff that I've done. But there are moments when you have to circle back around and make sure that you're coming to, even in CrossFit practice, make sure you're coming to it from these places of nonviolence, truthfulness, non-stealing, all of that. You're preparing yourself, your mind, the way that you view yourself in the world. You evaluate the entire context of where you are in the world in order to come into the action of asana, for example, of the poses. So nonviolence, I think, is such an important aspect of all of this, especially as it pertains to Westerners, because, if you think about, so I'm flipping to the chapter itself, the ahimsa chapter. As I was taking notes, I eventually stopped using my highlighter. Number one, because it dried out on me, because I was using it so much in this chapter. Finally, I'm just like, I'm kind of highlighting everything she's saying. And then I just started using pencil marks and like highlighting an entire, like just saying, okay, this whole paragraph. But there's only, what I find interesting is that there's only one aspect where she talks about physical violence, and she equates it to Mr. Miyagi in The Karate Kid. And what I love about that story where, you know, Ralph Macchio's character comes to Mr. Miyagi and he just finds this like peaceful old man that's picking up flies with chopsticks. And he's like, you know, this guy, how is this guy going to teach me, you know, karate? It's very similar to when, okay, I'm a Star Wars fan. I don't know if you know that. When Luke goes to Dagobah and he's like, I'm looking for this master Jedi, and he runs into this little green troll guy who's, you know, tearing shit apart or whatever. And what we learn from Mr. Miyagi, Yoda, so forth, is that there are times when you, first of all, you're coming to life not assuming that everything is going to get you. So you don't come into a situation assuming that everything is going to become a fight. You bring your energy as a peaceful energy into a situation. However, you don't come into it ignorant. So, and this is what we'll look at with all the rest of the stuff that's part of the yamas and the niyamas, is you're still prepared. You know, you're still we'll learn about reading the texts and being educated and intelligent, coming into things that way. So you're not coming into a situation ignorant, But you do also, in a nonviolent ahimsa way, you also rest your body. You're not constantly being aggressive with yourself physically. One of these, I debated whether or not I wanted to bring this up. So a couple of years ago on my Facebook page, a cousin of mine who, I don't really know him, I've never met him, but he's just sort of like a distant cousin. He posted a picture of a girl wearing, I'm going to call them tight pants with a gun in the pocket. And he said, and it said yoga pants. And I'm like, those aren't yoga pants. And he goes, well, why aren't those yoga pants? So this starts this whole long argument on Facebook about why they these tight black pants, like what Kelly's wearing, can't possibly be yoga pants. And I'm like, because yoga pants wouldn't have a gun in them. And so then it derailed into this argument about, well, so if somebody brings a gun and puts a gun in your face, you're not going to fight back. I'm like, I did not say that, and we're not going to get into this. And I was like, look, this whole discussion is not happening on Facebook. However, I did try to explain, like, yoga comes from a place of nonviolence. I tried to describe and explain ahimsa to this guy. And finally, I ended up, I was like, look, we're done with this conversation. I'm deleting this. And the act of deleting that from my Facebook page, in my mind, was also an act of ahimsa, of nonviolence. Because, I mean, in just a few hours, not only my own arguments with this guy, but my stepmother jumped in to defend me, and like other people were coming in, and other people who practice yoga, and then gun lovers, and all this stuff. And I'm just like, this is too much, and it's Facebook. This is not the way to have this conversation. So nonviolence is not just a physical thing. It is the primary thing that of this entire chapter, of the entire concept that I want you to get out of it. I think the second most important thing in this entire concept, and she says it right in the beginning, is talking about balance. You know, balancing, and Kelly, you talk about this a lot. The definition of disease is dis-ease, you know, and it comes from all sorts of things. You know, what you have or haven't eaten, what you have or haven't drank. You know, too much or too little exercise, those types of things. It doesn't necessarily mean that you have the flu. It means that you are unbalanced. You are not at ease. So I'm interested to hear my main points that I just wanted to bring up at the head of the conversation was, it's not all about physical violence. And I wanted to point out, it's very important to look at this from a balance standpoint. So with that, I wanna hear everybody else's thoughts on this. So as you went through this chapter, what are the things that stood out to you or felt, you know, that really, you know, spoke to you about ahimsa and nonviolence?
Well, I wanted to say something to your point earlier about going into a workout. And being like, I'm gonna get my ass kicked, right? Just using that in the lexicon, right?
Sure.
How we use our words.
Yeah.
In the same vein, being a massage therapist in Chicago, it was, people would come in almost, I mean, I would have at least one patient, if not all of them, during the day, like, hey, you know, I know I want to feel the pain, you know, kind of thing.
Yeah.
That's the initial idea, is actually violence to themselves or pain to themselves, and that equals, you know, healing. And it's like, no.
Right.
I don't need to hurt you, you know? And after a while, like, at first I was watching other therapists and seeing like, oh, these people really like deep tissue, so I was watching their methods and things like that. And they would be bruised afterwards. And then I started doing more continuing education and finding that you can do really, really deep work without any pain. It's just about moving the muscles or having them actively contract the muscles while you're doing the release.
Yeah.
And we kind of just don't think about that. But the point is, yeah, it's like, and even if we look at surgery, you know, people automatically go, oh, I need surgery for this, or even doctors are recommending that.
Mm-hmm.
It's a violent act towards our body. It's cutting our bodies open. And it's what the medical field really knows
right
today, you know, is like the cut. and pace kind of method versus having preventative measures. And that's what's so awesome about having this as the first part of the awareness of it, because it is. It's like we actually are now pointing violence towards healing, and it just does not work.
Yeah.
Like that, you know?
That's a really great point. And you know, it makes me wonder, like, where did we, I'm just gonna lump us as Westerners. You know, I'm not anything other than a Westerner, so I have no idea what other people think about when they go in for a massage. But like, where did all of that start? You know, like, that we think that, like, that old whole idea of no pain, no gain.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that's been around for ages. And if it doesn't hurt, you're not, you know, putting enough effort into it or something like that, you know.
You
like,
know, I honestly think it's from maybe one or two times that were publicized very heavily. So,
yeah.
For example, like the Rice Protocol, rest, ice, compression, inhalation.
Yeah.
8 years later, the doctor that wrote that wrote an entire book about why it's not right.
Interesting.
And so, but nobody saw that book. We only mm-hmm. just remember rice. I mean, to this day, 2018, people
yeah.
are still talking about that.
Yeah.
It's like that doctor years ago wrote a book about how he was wrong about it.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
interesting, right?
So. That really is, yeah. And that is a really good point. Anybody else have any comments, even a response to what Patrick said?
My favorite part, the part that stuck out to me, was the part about the can of paint, treating yourself as you would treat other people.
Yeah.
And you wouldn't, oh, if you, the colors on the outside of the paint, you expect yeah. inside to be the same color.
Yeah.
I love that analogy.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like you can't pour water from an empty pitcher. And I think that rang true, because I have friends and family members who are either, you know, they work themselves to the ground helping other people that they never took care of themselves, or the opposite, where they're attuned to themselves but they don't help other people. So
yeah.
just the balance and being just as kind to yourself as
mm-hmm.
much other people. I like that metaphor a lot.
Yeah. And sort of circling back to a couple of months ago, several months ago in our class on compassion, where we really sort of beat it in talking about the idea that compassion is in and of itself a selfish act, because when you give something to somebody, you enjoy the act of giving. So, but you have to build yourself up in order to be able to give that thing to somebody, and being kind to yourself, for some reason we see that as selfish. Treating yourself kindly, practicing nonviolence to yourself, why is that strange? Why is that weird? Why is it that we even have a concept of self-care? That it's had to come to that where we say, I'm gonna spend an hour of self-care today. Really?
Should be mandatory.
Yeah, right. You know, I mean, you know, arguably like brushing your teeth and all the stuff that you're doing, that, but that's just the physical stuff, right? I mean, it also sort of is intertwined with this idea that we have with mental illness, where why is it separate from physical illness? You know, why do we treat people that are bipolar or anything else so different from somebody who has a broken leg or the flu or cancer or all of that? You know, taking care of the inside of yourself doesn't make you soft or weak or selfish. It's a necessity.
Well, and then back to the way that we treat mental health in the healthcare system with
yeah.
chemicals, very, very violent chemicals.
Yeah.
You know, so it's like they have the.
When in truth, you know, what they're finding is a lot of these things are created by inflammation. You can likely affect your mental health by reducing inflammation in your body.
Yeah, they talk about the little kid that
yeah.
full of shit.
Yeah.
And he acted out because he felt like shit on the inside. So he's like gonna treat people like shit.
Yeah.
Because of it. Yeah.
Man, I remember being, so it broke my back like 10 years ago or something.
Good Lord.
I remember being so mad at everything.
Yeah.
And even like, and in and out of like drug hazes from the Percocets that they gave me to kill the pain, but like it's just insane, like how much of a different person I was. And then like people telling me afterwards, dude, the things you said to me, I'm like, what did I even see? You know what I mean?
Right. Like,
whoa. And yeah, I mean, my body felt like crap. I felt like I wasn't being taken care of at the hospital. And until I got with a physical therapist who empowered me with self-care, you know, that it was only then that I had any inkling of hope to, like, be able to skateboard again and walk again. Because
yeah.
Every doctor was like, no, you're not going to do that. Restrictive. What is that? It gives you no hope, you know. And I don't want to, like, completely tear down the healthcare system, because I think that
sure.
There's still a balance within them. There's still very good doctors, but it is what I see on a majority basis, you know?
Yeah. So. Yeah.
I think to his point though, like, you know, how you feel on the inside often reflects outwardly, and coming back to that whole thing, like reading this chapter, I'm thinking about people in my life, you know, that I have challenges with. And then I have to think to myself, okay, what's going on inside of them? Like, what are the things that they're telling themselves? Because clearly, when they come out at me negatively, something else is going on to them. And that always really, when I read this book the first time, that was the one thing I really took from this, is that you'll treat people outwardly how you treat yourself, and you can't always mask that. The energy is there. It's not even just in your words and actions. It's like you bring that to a space. And it's crazy, I think, in the world we live in, that self-esteem is such a thing. Like, it's such an issue that people don't feel empowered to be who they want to be, or you know, they don't feel like they'll be accepted. And
when everybody's feeling that same way.
Everyone.
That's
yeah.
the shit of it.
Yes.
It's like,
yeah. like
we all feel
we're
not
all
worthy.
Insecure about
yes.
things. That's
right.
life, you know? But how can we, like, you know, get past that? And it's kind of like that mental game of, like, you know, turning off the noise, really. Mm-hmm. Because, and I used to have a lot of that, like, just self-talk that would be really negative. For what? You know, it was like,
right.
why? And then I had to be like, that doesn't even, like, that's not even applicable to my life. Like, you're fine.
Right. Nobody said
so,
it to you. You
right.
created
I
it.
I said it to
head.
Myself.
Yes, right.
And it was out of nothing, you know?
Yeah.
And so the first time I read this book, that really changed the dialogue in my own mind about the things I said about myself. And she talks about that, like, talking about the story you build about yourself, the
yes.
things that you define that you are, or that other people think of you, and you just use that as, like, your kind of, like, repetitive, like, noise.
Yeah.
And just breaking the cycle of that is, I think, really difficult.
Yes.
But that's why this one's so important.
Yes.
Because once you can break that, then you're like, oh, yeah, I
yeah.
am great. Like, this life is great, you know? Like.
Yeah.
And in that same vein, you can, like, turn that noise into a mantra, perhaps. Like,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Don't necessarily have to kill it, you know. You can,
right.
You can do
yeah,
it.
Yeah, just
right?
yeah. Switch the words. Switch the wording.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, like, you're not good enough. Oh wait, no, you are good enough.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
like, that simple.
Yeah, I went to a corporate blah blah thing when I was a blah blah corporate person, but one of the things that stuck out that this guy said, we went around the room and we talked about things, and I said, oh yeah, you know, I don't like. I'm not good with people. Like, I'm not social. And he's like, why don't you stop saying that? And then, I mean, because you're creating your own, the whole, you know, you're putting yourself in that box. Nobody else is doing it for you. So if you say it over and over again, you're going to believe it. Like,
mm-hmm.
oh, I must not be good with people. Like, awkward is one thing. That doesn't mean that you're not,
right.
So you can't be social. And in the same vein, you know, saying like, oh, I have a terrible memory, well, then you're gonna have a bad memory if you just sort of like settle into that and believe it.
Yeah, dude, our language has so much to do with how our psychology is.
Yeah,
like it is interlinked completely.
Yeah,
I was listening to this podcast the other day, and they're talking about, it's like a hidden brain one. They're talking about this. There was a linguist, and she studied this Australian Aboriginal tribe, and for their greeting, they don't have hello, right?
Mm.
Their greeting is literally, in which direction are you heading?
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And
how are you going?
Yes, how are you going?
Instead of how are you going?
And your answer is the direction.
The direction that you're going.
Yeah.
And it's proven that those people can orient themselves so much better, like on a vastly higher scale than people who don't have that within their language, you know? So it is, it's like,
your language,
it is the language that we use. It's the lexicons, the words that we use, you know?
Yeah, which is, I don't want to get political. I'm going to stop that right there.
Come on,
that's all you need to say.
Yes, I'm going to stop that right there, and we're going to carry on. So I do want to move on, because I wanted to, her stories that that sort of relates to compassion and others was her story about how her husband would always carry stuff for her.
Mm-hmm.
And that's nice, honey. However, now I don't carry my own stuff and I'm growing weak, you know,
mm-hmm.
physically, you know. So when you do things for other people and you don't let them do for themselves, then the way that she says, we both devalue and insult others when we worry about them. What an interesting concept to me. That, you know, you automatically assume that I can't do something, or that, you know, I need the help, but maybe I would like to do it for myself because I want to see, can I do it? Maybe I'll grow stronger. Failure is such a stupid word to have in your vocabulary anyway. Like, I mean, you're the one defining whether or not something's a failure. As opposed to, oh, well, that didn't go well. Let's learn from it and do something different then.
It's more like opportunity.
Right, yes.
Yeah.
I avoid that because it's such a corporate term.
Well, yeah, but it's like an opportunity to learn from
yes.
that.
Yes. Yeah, right, yeah. But that truly is. And so showing compassion and nonviolence, so, you know, towards somebody else in the same vein of, you know, you're using... being mindful of the way that you think about somebody else,
mm-hmm.
because that reflects the way that you think about somebody is then acted out by you, and you either, you know, block them from growing or whatever. So that I thought that was interesting. It sort of was like a left turn for me, concept, but I like it. It's a little bit hard for me to see how it fits into Ahimsa, but I still like it.
Real quick, sorry, I keep going to the massage thing, but it is important.
Yeah.
But so an example from massages that people will come in, and I would have regulars that would start to come in and say, I need you, I need your help,
mm-hmm.
I need you to like release this muscle for me. Every time it would be the same thing that I was doing.
Yeah.
And after a while, ethically, I felt wrong about continuing to see these patients. So I had to have a conversation, like, listen, like either you start doing the actual self-care that I'm giving you and start really like working on this, or else you're never gonna get better and you can't rely on me for the rest of your life.
Right, yeah.
You know what I mean? Then that's me like saying like, no, please don't pay me. And that's just where capitalism really fucks everything up.
Right, it's
and,
true.
And, but, you know, because people don't understand, well, I'm paying you. And it's like, no, this is about you healing yourself. And I don't want to see you again, not because I don't like you, but because you need to start empowering yourself.
Right.
You know,
it's the idea that, you know, teach a man to fish.
Mm-hmm.
Don't just give him a damn fish.
Mm-hmm.
You don't benefit, nobody benefits from somebody just giving you something. You know, you need to earn it, you need to know what you're doing, you need to understand your piece in the machine. You know, enabling people to help themselves is so important.
To them.
Yes.
Well, yeah, in the sense that you could look at it like, well, dude, like, you go out and walk it and you twist your ankle and the muscles that you didn't work on are messed up. You know,
right.
Like, that's violence against yourself. That's me being violent to you.
Oh, that puzzle has been inching out.
I know.
Oh, whoa.
It's from my boot.
Oh, it's your boot.
Yeah.
So, let's see here. What other points? My gosh. This truly is like, I pretty much just highlighted the whole thing.
I know. When I read it the first time, I remember underlining like every other thing.
On to the same point, I thought of something that I could do differently, and I don't know other people do this, but when people are in pain or sick or something, my first instinct is to be like, okay, it's super, can I bring anything? Like,
yeah.
Do you want us to talk about it? You know, maybe you should try listening to happy music, like, oh,
yeah.
Or whatever the thing might be. But I've realized I can still get the same effect without telling them how to do things.
Right.
By just being like, I'm here for you if you need anything,
yeah.
Or if you want to talk about it. And then it's in their court if they want to rely on me for anything.
Yeah.
But I feel like that's a small change I can make in my relationships to be less violent.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And equal.
Yeah, I think that's super
important.
Yeah,
the whole like idea of trying to fix people, or like I think she even says, if you can't find love in yourself, it becomes easy to look outward and try to fix other people.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And like going back to that whole like the worrying about other people.
Yeah.
That one really struck a chord for me.
Yeah.
Daddy issues on that one.
Yeah.
But yeah, my dad would always be like, oh, I'm so worried about you. Like, you're off on your own doing these things. And it's like, I'm an adult.
Yeah.
Like, even now, to this day, people still do that to me. And I'm like, I've traveled all over the world by myself.
Yeah.
And yet you still don't think I can, like, walk this earth alone. You know what I mean? It's like, but that, to me, I'm reading this and it's like, yeah, it's him not being kind.
Right.
You know, and it sucks. It sucks to like know that like someone doesn't trust that you can do something.
Yeah.
So yeah.
And I remember, you know, my own parents saying like, oh well, it's not you, it's the other person.
Oh yeah, like we're not
like,
worried about
whatever.
Yeah. But it is.
Whatever.
It is the worry of you because you're the one.
Yes. Yeah. You know, like, yeah, okay, well, that's great. There are always going to be other people in the world. Like, there are always people on the road driving when
yeah.
I'm driving. That's the nature
always.
Of this. Yeah, like, I need to drive, you know, so I learn how to drive. Like,
yeah.
That's called life. It's a funny thing.
I feel like that's but to be like, I'm worried about you because you are driving. It's like, okay, well, I'm driving, you know, like that's the difference.
Give me a call when you get home, it's more endearing as a friend.
Yeah, that's like,
yeah.
Hey, I want to know that you're alive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think that's the fear that they talked about that keeps us from living.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, it's fear. It's fear. Yeah, she does. Dive into
control.
It's like the idea of also gaslighting. Like if you make people believe that there's something wrong, then they're gonna start to think that something's wrong.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if your parents are constantly afraid for you, then you're like, oh, maybe there is something terrible out there.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
dude, look at War of the Worlds in the 1950s. Was that
right.
Everybody in America. There's the Western idea.
Right, yes, right, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. So did anybody, looking at the exercises, did anybody actually practice them? I'll be honest, I looked back on past week.
Oh,
I did. Yeah, I finished it this morning.
Fair enough.
But I think number week three, the one about fixing other people, is something I have noticed recently that I do.
Yeah, so the difference between are you a worrier, a fixer, and discerning the difference between help and support. I think that that is a great point. I need to help you because the underlying unspoken word is you don't know what you're doing, or you don't, you can't do it yourself, versus support, meaning you can do it and I'm back here if you need me, just let me know. I think that is a good, I think there is a fine distinction in that. Although I think it's hard. Like, I'm not going to stop saying, like, can I help or something like that, you know, like, but it's your intention.
Start to, like, build a guideline, like the demonstration, right? That's what they're talking about then. Don't tell people how to do it, but demonstrate.
Right.
I think that's a huge thing that really is actually reflective right in a class, in a yoga class. Right?
Yeah.
Is that you have a literal demonstrator who can give you the guidelines to do it, but yoga is yourself.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. Well, you know, and I know that Kelly's like this as well. When I teach, I do very little hands-on adjustments. My thing is like, if you're going to hurt yourself, that's one thing. If I'm not explaining it in a way that your body is getting it, then I'm going to try to do something. But for the most part, like, figure out how it feels in your body, because at the end of the day, it's not about how it looks or any of that. It's like how this whole, how awesome it feels in your body. And it does have to come from within. And yeah, you know, if you've got somebody who continuously puts you into a pose, then yeah, you're not going to figure it out for yourself. Yeah, you're going to be doing my
pose. Get you deeper into a pose.
Right.
Right, because then it's like, why can't I go deeper on my own?
Right, yeah. Right, exactly, yes, yeah. So week one in her list here, this week, practice courage by doing one thing daily that you wouldn't normally do. Yeah, I had every intention of doing that one.
Sometimes it's hard though. It's like you,
yeah,
like the what are the opportunities to like take a different way to work? Like I don't know, like,
yeah,
talk to someone you don't normally talk to, maybe if you see them and you're, I don't know.
And I think that, like, for me, sometimes things that I wouldn't normally do, like things that are going against my character, speaking up when I think that I'm wrong, or if I'm not sure that what I want to say actually fits into the conversation, or that it will be received well, or that I'm going to say it right. I second guess myself a lot, and I keep stuff in my mouth instead of putting it out of my mouth. It's amazing how much I actually don't say, considering how much I actually do talk. Believe it or not, there's a lot of shit that I don't say. but that one's hard, because I think, you know, it is different to for each person. Like, what is it that you, how would you define yourself as being brave or courageous? What's the thing that you don't do, because you're afraid? You know, it's different for every person.
I guess maybe like one that could apply to everybody is like the way they get somewhere, like transportation, like taking a bike or going on a trip, like a train or a bus, or taking an Uber if you've never taken an Uber.
Yeah, because I will say, like, I've never done an Uber because I don't know how to, and I'm scared, and because like there's one other, it's you and this stranger in the car.
You do know that's how we met, right?
I do know that. Right.
Yeah.
Were you
driving? I am a driver.
Yeah. See.
I'm taking it.
Right. You can leave your car there.
That's good. Wow. Well, no, I was just gonna say, like, the guy that was with you was like, you know, they get in the car, and my regular protocol is like, you guys have a preference on music or whatever. And Jared was like, oh, whatever you want, man. And like Kelly was like, I don't know, Uber drivers normally can't pick songs, right? You know. And I was like, I got something, you know. And I played the song, and she was like, oh my god, I'm gonna use this in my yoga class.
And then, I literally said that. Yeah.
And then you just started talking. So.
And the rest is history.
Yeah, the rest is history.
It's awesome.
But I understand that goes back to that fear.
Yep.
That keeps us from living.
Yeah.
I haven't done it either. You know, you hear all those bad stories.
Yeah,
but that's like one
you may get devaluing me, which
right.
is awesome.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. But yeah, but like, you know, where would society have gotten? Where would our people have gotten if we didn't do things we didn't know how to do, you
right.
know?
Totally.
Or were a little bit afraid,
yeah.
you know? Like, my God, good thing my mom wasn't afraid to give birth because of the pain.
Right, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you know, sometimes you just gotta do it.
I'm afraid to cook raw meat in my kitchen, but I've
yeah.
taken steps. I bought a meat thermometer, but I still,
yeah.
I still have purchased raw chicken, because I just don't.
And
it's
still
week
one.
You got
the rest of the week, girl.
Right. Well,
add that chicken.
And then if you think about talking about like all of evolution, like our whole being has been built on raw food that we've cooked, and we all survive.
My grandpa, who hated tomatoes, always said the bravest man alive is the man who ate the first tomato.
Yeah.
Because
it's all relative.
Yeah. It's true. It ate all the things.
Right. Yeah. Somebody had to try it. Is
well,
this poisonous?
Someone,
I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Someone had to eat the poisonous berry
and die.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Don't
or
eat
the
that.
Mushroom or whatever.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Good things have come out.
Yeah.
Right.
And week two, this week, guard your balance as you would your most precious resource. So I like this one a lot. This one for me is when it comes to exercise and food and things like that. That's hard for me. Because I'm extremely competitive, especially with myself. This is where yoga comes in, like every moment of my life. And so I have to find that balance and make sure that I'm not pushing myself too hard, make sure that I'm eating enough food, because I run that balance of, well, if I want to lose weight so that I can be a little bit faster when I run, then I maybe shouldn't eat this food. Well, in order to have energy, in order to run and do yoga and all this stuff, I gotta eat. So, you know, there's that balance. There absolutely is that balance. And when you are imbalanced and having dis-ease, then again, as she says here, notice the effects on your life and on others, whether you're balanced or not. In one of our mindfulness practices, I don't know how much we actually talked about it, but eating mindfully and not stuffing yourself up to your neck when you eat, which is how I love to eat. However, it's so uncomfortable to be full that you're just miserable and you can't do the thing. But that's another kind of thing. In balance, not going to the extremes, you know, recognizing when you've had just enough wine and one more glass and you're tipped over. Maybe literally.
Yeah.
So watching that balance, you know, having some alcohol is okay. Having too much alcohol is not okay. So I really like that one.
Ooh, you know what I was just thinking about too is cooking food violently. Like I thought about my older cooking habits, and I would just like throw the chicken on, cut it up, you know.
Right.
But when you take your time and actually like be cognizant of what you're doing with it, and be a little more gentle with the food, it actually cooks a little
tastes
bit
better. Yeah. I always tell him like timing is
is
like the secret of cooking.
For
yeah.
Sure.
That's
letting things simmer, letting things just like.
And that's so
non-violent.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's the same way with like grilling. Like the best way to do it is to only flip it once.
Yeah.
Being
patient enough.
Exactly, and then just you flip it the once, and then you put it on the plate, and you're like, there's a ghost plate.
When I did my yoga teacher training out in White Lotus, she's no longer there, but they had a chef, Beatrix, who was a vegan chef, and part of our yoga training was spending some time with her, and she would talk about how, as you're making the food, think about the people that you're making it for, even yourself, and you're putting love into the food. And so then when you're, you know, ripping the lettuce to make the salad, you're ripping it with love and all of that, and thinking about the emotions that you have in you, and, you know, whether or not you're pushing that into the food. Is it good energy? Is it bad energy? It's really important. Yeah. I actually made a turkey for Thanksgiving.
Real turkey?
I'm vegetarian. Yeah. And so, like, this whole... But I did it because Aaron's family was coming over. And so as I'm, like, the only way I could get through it was I'm, like, massaging this turkey. And I'm like, okay, this turkey died for this. I'm going to respect the spirit of this poor bird who died for this. And I'm going to... And I did. I thought about what it was probably like as a bird, its life, and I'm like, all right, so I'm going to honor you by making you the tastiest dinner. And everybody loved the turkey, so.
There you go.
Yeah.
They taste the love.
Yeah. Everybody was like, did Aaron make this turkey? I'm like, no, damn it, the vegetarian made the turkey.
Yeah.
Thank
That's
you.
That's bad love.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Yeah. And then so week four. Pretend you are complete. That's hard. That's really hard.
I feel like that's been my life challenge in week four.
Yes. Yes. I mean, that's why I feel like Ahimsa being the first one, this is really hard. This is hard. Ahimsa is hard. I feel like you need all the other ones first to work up to this. But I think pretending that you're complete means that you also need to face the things that you think are incomplete and acknowledge them and actually say them out loud, for example, you know, maybe admitting something, maybe digging deep and figuring out, why do I think that I'm not complete? Does anybody have an example personally? It's hard.
On completion?
Yeah.
Well, I'll give you an example of what I'm incomplete. I think that really, I feel like it's external stuff, or it's things that I want, things that I want to leave my mark on the world. So for music, for example, I've been producing music for 20 years, and I have not finished an album ever.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So that's something in me that feels incomplete. Although, I think that when I really look at it, it's the societal pressures that make me feel incomplete, because there's other complete albums out there, you know, that are successful. And so I kind of measure myself towards that versus, like, I do have, like, hundreds of songs that I've made, that I've loved, that I've, you know, and made it for me because I like the way the music sounds. So what am I really...
Well, I guess, you know, my question would be, so you've been talking about societal standards, like, why do you feel you have to make an album? Because these days, do people buy a full album? Can you just put out individual songs?
It's still.
But
and
you
I
just
totally
think
could.
That's the package that has to come
right.
in.
Right.
Yeah.
Sure.
For what, though? Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you don't have to.
That comparison, like, it's
not. Yeah, right.
Yeah. I think in a lot of ways, when I start comparing, it's just like, it's like this dark cloud that's
started kind of restart my career about like 3.5 years ago, and I'm actually considering in a really good place right now, and I really enjoy what I'm doing, but I'm still always thinking, like, all right, well, what else can I be learning? What, like, who else can I be networking with? Like, what other, like, I even see job, like, postings, and I'm not actively looking for a job, but I save a ton of them because I can go back and look at them later and, like, think, oh, well, this is something that they want, so how can I get, you know, experience in that, which I think in one way is good, but at the same time, I am saving, you know, multiples a week, and I probably just have like hundreds of them saved, and it's like, why do I?
And you're not applying for that.
Right? No, exactly. It's like, why don't I just have
applying?
Like a few?
You start applying.
Well, but that's the thing, is like, I like where I am,
right?
And so I don't want to be applying, but I'm still looking out for like the job that's like 3 years down the road or 10 years down the road.
Well, you know what I mean? It's like,
and it's just,
it's like you're mentally hoarding, like. Isn't that part of the structure, right?
taking more than what you need.
Has it come in through the light? but I just, yeah, I don't know. It's just, yeah.
That's interesting. I think careers have played a big part of that too, because I feel that way as well. Like, I just got a new manager, and I was kind of playing the role, you know, until she stepped in. And then I started learning so many things that she started doing. I'm like, shit, why didn't I think to build that itself?
Right. And you mean by to yourself that
and
you're
then,
saying.
Yeah, and I was like, right, got down on myself because
But you're not, like,
yeah.
Different people bring different things,
right? And I totally appreciated that, you know, she came in because it took weight off of my shoulders and I was learning a lot from her and I'm very appreciative of that. But then I still had that, why didn't I think that, you know?
Yeah.
Which is weird because you're being violent to, like, your present self, even
right.
though it was, like, your past self,
and
you didn't know about something,
yeah.
and it's like, and now you, like, you learned it, and now you're, like, a better person because of it, but you're still beating up
right.
your present self,
exactly.
Wow, and I did
yeah.
the same thing,
exactly.
damn it.
Yeah.
So, with your list, though, what do you think is something that, do you want to start applying?
No, I think, honestly, I actually think it's more of a habit that I got in, because I completely changed careers. I had no job, and I was in school full-time, and then I just started, so I'm a librarian, so I just started shelving books. And so it was always like, all right, well, what can I learn while I'm shelving books so I can get the next one? And then I'm checking in books. And it's like, what can I learn while I'm checking in books so I can do that? And now it's like, you know, talking to vendors and managing, you know, large databases and things like this. And it's just, all right, well, I'm learning all this stuff, but what else can I be learning on the side? What other, like, little thing can I be taking on? And then, of course, like, this week was just kind of a busier week. And then now I'm, like, a little swamped. And I have a dentist appointment tomorrow, and it's like, well, crap, it's gonna be less time in the week to be able to do all this stuff, and it's just, yeah, so, it's just.
I don't know, more like finite scale, like, there's a program I use called Ableton to make beats and stuff, and you have unlimited amounts of clips or just like little samples that you can put into it or whatever, and I will go so far into it that like my tracks are just like, 100 sounds thick, you know what I mean?
Like,
by the end of it, it's just a jumbled mess. I'm like, man, if only I could just simplify.
Uh-huh.
And when I take it down to beat, bass, and harmony, then it's like, oh, that's sick.
That's why the Beatles were so good.
Yeah.
They were so simple. All right, so in the we've got 5 minutes left. So for next week, going back to the table of contents. Satya, truthfulness. So the next chapter, truthfulness, I think it's, so you'll see a lot of similarities to all of the yamas, similar concepts. So truthfulness is such a fine line between nonviolence and truthfulness,
mm-hmm.
you know, being true to yourself. You can see how these things truly do overlap. Like a Venn diagram of like all of the yamas, like they're all connected.
Mm-hmm.
So being real rather than nice. So just reading this description of the table of contents. Self-expression versus self-indulgence. I mean, truly, like, you can take these words and put them under the nonviolence section as well. The need to belong versus the need to grow. Do it right the first time. Truth is fluid. Truth has weight, the power of truth. And then we'll go for the questions at the end of the thing. So so yeah, take a look at that for next week. Take a look at the exercises as well. And you know, I'm always gonna say, like, try to journal. I'm a big journaler. You know, one of the things that I find is truly important about journaling is, at least for me, when I'm in the moment, when I think of something right then, that's when I have the most passion, all of the feelings for that thing that happened or that I thought about or whatever. And, you know, it's just like when you wake up and you still have a little bit of the dream in your head. You're like, oh, I can remember it. It was so, like, it's indelible. And then, like, you're making coffee and then you want to tell somebody. You're like, I had this dream. I don't remember a thing about it, you know. But right when you woke up, you're like, oh, yeah, I'll never forget this. I don't need to write it down. But write it down. When I So for any of you who are in the journaling thing, when I journal, I write down the day of the week, the date. I even go so far as to write the time. Because when I look back on my journals, I don't necessarily read all the stuff, but it's interesting to me to see, like, what time of day did I have the desire to write? You know, it meant something to write in the morning versus the evening. A change in, notice how you, like, your energy level. You know, I've said this before, like, you know, from the hours of 4 to 7 p.m., and I have no idea why, it's probably, you know, the setting of the sun and all that stuff. Like, I say the worst things about myself to myself from 4 to 7 p.m. I have no idea. So take a look at those types of things when you're, you know, if you do decide to write in a journal. And if you're going to write in a journal, be as honest as possible. Don't necessarily think that because I'm writing it down, somebody else is going to read it. This isn't the internet. You know, if you can't be honest with yourself in a journal, when can you be honest with yourself? If, you know, your own mind is the thing that's tricking you and lying to you and telling you all this nasty shit, then challenge yourself. Like, you know, one of the things was try to be courageous. Try to write the honesty about the thing, the truth of it. And I think that there is a difference between truth and honesty. Because you can say things that are true, but, like, honesty to me is something much deeper. Like, I can say the words, but, like, if I actually say the feeling of something, that to me is, like, the honesty of something. Next week, truthfulness.
Are we not doing two?
The last, well, I mean, we can do, 1 week we do need to do two. I was going to cram it all into the last week of February to do two things. Non-excess and non-possessiveness. But we could do truthfulness and non-stealing. What do you want?
Oh, I don't care.
This can be a democracy. It is a democracy. Why not? Do we want to do one?
So which
do
ones
do
are
two?
Shorter, right?
Boy, they all look great.
Let's see.
Nice.
16. They're all the same.
Yeah, they do.
Just do cram them all into one.
All right. Well, if you can get to two, then let's do two next week. We'll do non-stealing as well, Asteya. And if we don't get to it, then we'll keep on trying. Yeah. So see what you can do with truthfulness and non-stealing. And then we'll meet same bat time, same bat channel next week. Yeah. Keep practicing HIMSA.